you've ever wanted to shoot under night vision, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. Guys, like and comment. Comment section is out of control. If you guys are looking to support the channel, the biggest supporter of the channel right now is Big Daddy Unlimited. Big Daddy Unlimited is like the Costco of the gun world. Get in there. First month is 99 cents. Of course, we have Vertex and Forsyk plaid and gloves and LAX ammunition. Ladies, gentlemen, and my often forgotten, but not by me, 300 Blackout. Welcome to the channel. Today, we're going to be talking about the B.E. Myers Mall. Let's get into it. Guys, welcome to the channel. Today we're going to be talking about a very interesting piece of technology, and that is going to be the B.E. Myers Mall. Really cool piece of tech. So as far as my involvement with B.E. Myers, I do use a lot of their products for work, like the Islet and a couple others. So understand that I have used their products before. The mall, however, was purchased by me. The DA is on loan from them for this particular video. I didn't have any contact with them or anything like that up until very recently, as I talked about making this video, and I just wanted to clarify some things with their engineers and make sure I had my stuff square before I went ahead with my review. That's pretty typical. No exchange, they haven't bought me dinner or anything like that. There's no exchange of money. There's no B.E. Myers collusion, but they're a very cool company. I hope to work with them in the future because I do like them all quite a bit. Okay, with those things out of the way, let's talk a little bit about the mall. So the mall came out for civilian use around 2017 or so. And that's when I first purchased mine. I purchased one of the first units that was out there because I really wanted to get some time on it. Now, why it's taken me so long to do a review is that IR devices are such an interesting beast. The PEC 15 is such a proven unit and has been used all over the world. And has been proven successful. The B.E. Myers is so radical and so different in so many ways. I wanted time, both for myself to get hands-on time with it, to use it, to put it through tens of thousands of rounds. And I also wanted to give time to a couple buddies who are using them in real-world situations to give them time to formulate a good opinion, see how they held up in harsh conditions, and kind of would see what happened to it, whether it held up or not. So, with technology like this, sometimes we're gonna have to wait a little bit more because we can't immediately push out the review on that. So I'm sorry, it's a little bit longer in coming, but it is finally here. Now, if you're not familiar with B.E. Myers, B.E. Myers makes a ton of different IR products already. Now, as far as a carbine-mounted IR device, this is one of the first that they've made. But needless to say, they are very familiar with the IR game, and they've been doing it for a long time. So don't feel like this is a newcomer, you're like, who the hell is B.E. Myers? This is an L3 or Steiner. I understand that, but I understand they've been in the game for a long time, especially the military game, so they do know what they're doing. Now, as far as the MAL, what does it stand for? The MAL stands for Modular Advanced Weapon Laser. Makes a lot of sense. Pretty cool term, too. As far as what it is a full-featured IR unit that has a visible green laser and has a IR laser and IR illuminator. This is, of course, important for shooting in low light situations when utilizing night vision. Now, the question is why do I need an IR illuminator, which is visible under night vision, but not visible by the naked eye? Why would I need that since I'm under night vision? Night vision amplifies the darkness so I can see. Well, depending on either the lighting conditions, for example, in urban environments, what happens is the lamps and the lights and window light and all that will spill out and it will throw shadows. Now, your IR unit auto-gates. What that means is it auto-adjusts brightness to ensure that you don't burn out the tubes. And because of this, you have darker areas. Those darker areas are easily seen with the use of IR illumination. Beyond that, in certain lighting conditions, especially when you're going indoors or subterranean, you absolutely need to have an IR unit because night vision works off of visible light. If there's no light to amplify, the night vision is going to have nothing to grab onto and it's going to be incredibly dark. That's why it's important to have an IR unit. So with those things out of the way, we understand what the MAL is. It's basically a PEC, but way better. And we'll talk about why it's way better. But before we get into that, let's talk a little bit about what makes up the MAL and why it's kind of cool. So first off, there are three pieces to this. I'm going to keep it as simple as possible for my Marines out there. You know, I love you guys yet. So we have the head, shaft, and butt right there for you. That is not the proper terminology. I'm sure B.E. Myers will yell at me about this later, but we're going to stick with that. And these are all separate pieces. We have the head right here. We have the middle unit in the back. Why that's cool is that if you are a right-handed shooter. So for example, I have this C1 Plus set up for right-handed shooting. So when I have it shouldered, I'm able to get onto the controls right there. But that can be easily reversed the other side. You simply pull the unit apart to its three constituent pieces and flip them, and then you have a left-handed maul. So that's a cool thing. It's very easily swapped to ambidextrous or something else. Another cool thing about the three separate pieces is that this can be easily upgraded. This is something that is not been done in the IRA world so far. It's kind of like the AR-15 of the IR world, in my opinion. So let's say that way better IR technology comes out. Well, you simply have to buy the head instead of buying the entirety of the shaft and the butt, the maul. So that's cool. Now, this is already paid off because the first butt cap that came with the maul was kind of substandard, in my opinion. However, the newest one that has come out is phenomenal. It's very easy to swap out batteries. You simply unscrew it, and then you can pop out the batteries. And it seems, like that's what it should have come with, but originally, due to the way they designed it, it was a not easy battery switch. So this is a much better way of doing it. So already, we've paid off from having this kind of thing. I know some of you guys might be like, well, this is awful. It's like some kind of EA DLC or something like that. But in my opinion, I think it's a very good thing. All right, now that we've talked about it, there are about three separate control features on this that lead you to getting the type of mode that you want. So let's talk about them. We'll do a little zoom in right here. So to start off with, at the very front, we have this propeller cap. Pretty easy. It says off. You twist it once. It says visible. Give your green laser beam. And then, let's see if you guys can see that. Nice. And then, of course, if we twist it all the way, it says IR. Pretty simple and self-explanatory, infrared. So a couple things to note is that when you do have it twisted to vis or IR, you do have battery drain, just like any other unit. So if I take my PEC 15 right here, or your LA5 or PEC 16, and you put it to either a visible laser or you put it all the way over to your IR lasers, that is going to be a constant battery drain, and eventually it will drain itself even when it's not turned on and you don't have the button pressed. So understand that that definitely comes through for the maul especially, so please make sure that when you're no longer utilizing it that you twist it to the off position. And it's fairly easy. When you have this thing shouldered, all you have to do is reach up and then give that thing a little twist, and you have it to whatever you need it to be to. So it's fairly easy to use. You can always reach up and do it. But the point is turn it to off. Is simplistic, and you should be doing it between missions. And besides that, I tend to actually change batteries completely on both my optics, my laser, and my light between different mission sets to ensure I'm on fresh batteries. Batteries are cheap, lives are not. So it's kind of my go-to on that. Okay, so we have the propeller at the front. So I turn it over to IR. Now I have two more control surfaces. I have my switch. So on the switch here at the very back, closest to the butt, is short range. That makes sense, close to the butt. If you push it up one, that is mid-range, and if you push it all the way up, you have to press down this little, and that goes into the high-powered mode. Those are our three different modes. We have short, mid, and then long. Besides that, we have two buttons right here, two fire buttons. The one that's closest to the head, that is alpha button, or A. The one closest to the butt, that's B. And if you swap this thing around, it's just whatever one's closest to the head. It just kind of reprograms itself. It's smart like that, not like... I'm gonna leave you Marines alone for today, like my Army guys out there. So that is, those are all the buttons that lead into controlling the unit. Now there's a couple other things I wanna talk about on this. First off, we have our screw right here, that's for mounting it. That's of course important to make sure you mount things correctly. I can't today. On the sides right here, we have our control surfaces for controlling our zero process. So this is the one unfortunate part of the maul, is going to be kind of deciding how you have your maul mounted. Because these are on the sides right there, if you have your light in a traditional position, such as right here, it does cover up one of these zeroing screws that you need. So that is kind of a pain. You do have to remove the light to re-zero that. So what a lot of guys who run mauls consistently do is that they take their light, they move it to the opposite side, it kind of balances out the whole unit, and they have a clicky cap on the back. So you just press it with your thumb to get your light, or you have your thumb on the maul itself. And I think that makes a lot more sense. As I use the maul a little bit more, I'm likely gonna be changing it back to that. But as of now, I have it in this less advantageous spot, but that is something to note. Another quick thing to note while we're on it is that depending on the size of your rail, you can get pretty close to this light. So right now I'm running a BCM rail, which is about as small of a rail I think most people are gonna be running in a kind of duty type situation, or just, it's one of the smaller rails. So I have an Arisaka light. Arisaka lights are fairly thin. They don't have the highest output, but they're very well made. and they're thin, which is nice. So if you have like a Surefire DF or a Mod Light, those are gonna be a little too thick in this position. So you're likely gonna have to have a slight offset mount, like an Arisaka offset mount, or you're gonna have to put it a M-Lock slot down to make sure that it has enough clearance off the maul. Otherwise the maul is gonna press into it and you're gonna have kind of fucky things going on with your zero. As a quick note to you guys. All right, now going from our zeroing, by the way, the zeroing does do both the IR and the visible, so they go together. What's nice about that is that when you zero your visible laser, that also zeroes your IR, both your illuminator and your laser beam, which is very cool. Some units have a zeroable laser and illuminator that are separate. I like to just have them together. I don't think there's any point to that. So what's a little bit different about the maul is it does sit at a different position than your typical IR unit. So PEC is more just right on top. Because of that, it's important to make sure that you have your zero kind of squared away. A lot of people tend to do a converging zero. What that means is they look through the optic and then they take the laser off their PEC or whatever, and they just line those both up, whether that be at 25 or 50 yards, and they're like, boom, zeroed, good. That's probably not the best option. I prefer a parallel zero where my laser is perpetually just offset from my aiming point. And what's nice about that is that they never converge. Because of that, I know that I'm always gonna have a hold. My impacts are gonna be slightly left and low of where my impacts are. And of course, getting your dope card or where those impacts are gonna be at various distances is going to be important, but make sure that you look at your zero and you know where things are gonna be impacting. But yes, I think parallel definitely works best in these situations. So anyhow, it's important to have a parallel zero on the maul. Just make sure you do it. It's on most IR optics. All right, moving back from there, on the bottom right here, we have two screws. So they're a little bit different. On the C1 Plus, the bottom screw is a normal mode, just for your typical NVG user. And then the screw closest to the head is the Alt mode. So the Alt mode was made because the maul doesn't really work that well with Photonis tubes because it's a little too good for Photonis tubes. So if you put in the Alt mode, it will work well for Photonis tubes, or as we lovingly call them, Portonis. So that is why they have those two screws there. Now on the DA, they just assume that everyone is using L3 tubes. Any professional end user, no professional end user would use a Photonis tube. I'm sure you guys are gonna get super pissed about that. But anyhow, we have a normal mode, and then if you go to the one closest to the head, instead of an Alt, it is a train mode. It puts it into a lower power. So that is the purpose of those screws. Moving past the shaft, we already know what's going on right there, all the way to the tail cap. We know that we can simply unscrew to pop out our batteries like we talked about earlier. And then of course we have two at-peel type switches. So any of your normal Surefire switches or at-peel switches work well with it, which is precisely what you want. That way you can still do that whole ambi thing with your maul. You can just kind of reach back a little bit further, just like my Navy guys. Another thing to note is that when this is put into the on position, just to the right of the switch, there's a small recessed LED. That LED indicates that the unit is either on or active. So on, of course, no button is being pressed. Active is, you know, when it's actually, when the button's pressed. So when it's on, it's simply yellow. You can see under nods, and then when it's on screen, of course, you can't tell color differences under nods, but if you're looking, if you're shooting the gap under your nods, or if you're checking this at night just for a quick function check without having your nods on, that's a nice thing to have. Now, nobody else is gonna see this. It's recessed, it's only facing towards you. It's a cool little feature just to have. So again, kind of going over it, there is nothing like the maul because of its ability to change modes very easily. Now, on top of that, it also uses very interesting illumination technology. Specifically, that technology is VC cell. Essentially, it's about a million little laser beams and they're all shooting out. And because of that, compared to like, let's say the PEC 15, the Steiner, or many other different IR devices out there, even IR lights like the Mod Light and others, it's not very visible downrange. The biggest thing is that it penetrates past photonic barriers. Penetration is important, as we know. But photonic barriers, what is that fancy word and what the fuck does it mean? Well, a photonic barrier is like a light, like let's say a street lamp. A street lamp spills down a bunch of light, and then your IR needs to be able to push past that. Say you're looking down a street, and past the street it's dark. Past that street light it's dark, and you need to be able to see what's on the other side. Many IR devices aren't powerful enough or don't have the correct technology to push past that. The maul can. That's incredibly important in a variety of different situations, both urban and rural. So the ability for it to do that in its own sets us apart from many other IR devices out there. Now, not to mention its ability to easily switch modes. So if you want to change the how wide your illumination is, it's pretty difficult on things like the PEC or pretty much any other IR device. Or even on the NGAL, which has some good things kind of going on and something like it. If you want to change your size of your focus ring on the PEC 15, you have to reach up and twist this. And that seems quite easy, but being that this is all the way forward on your weapon, you have to like reach up. So like if you're coming out from a room and you're going into an alleyway, it's kind of difficult to, as you're doing that, to reach up and manipulate that. So a lot of guys just end up just running them at a fixed kind of illumination point. Not to mention, the illumination on the PEC 15 doesn't get that wide. So if you're coming into a room, you're not seeing like full field of view of your entire field of view of what you typically see through binocular NVGs. So here's where the MAL absolutely rocks. The MAL has six different modes that can operate off of, and we'll talk about each of them at this time. So we're gonna go out, we're gonna actually have the MAL and also the DA and compare them to other different IR devices. Okay, to start off with, we have the MAL C1 Plus. We're gonna put it into short mode first. We're gonna go ahead and hit the A button for right now, A being forward. So as you can see, what you have is a 40 degree field of view for the illuminator with a laser dead center. Okay, so we have our C1 Plus for A. Now for B button is a shorter illuminator, still 40 degree, but it is just not as long of a throw and a slightly less powerful beam. Okay, from there, we're gonna compare that to the MAL DA. Put that to short mode. All right, turn that on A button. So as you can see with the MAL DA, we have a much more powerful laser, illuminator slightly more powerful, but otherwise fairly similar. For the B button, we have the same thing, shorter throw with the illuminator. As you can see, we have our little target right out there, and the pointer reaches well out to about 300 yards or so. All right, moving back to the C1 Plus, we're gonna push that up to mid-range mode for both of them. Here's a C1 Plus A button, mid-range. We have a 16 degree illuminator with a longer throw, easily reaching out to 300 meters. And illuminating that target right there, it's gonna be a little bit washed out because of how bright it is on this older tube that we're filming on. Through the L3s, it looks fine. And then further, it's perfect. B mode, again, just slightly less powerful on the wider throw on the 14 degree illuminator. Mid-range mode on the DA, a much more powerful spot. You can see the throw is pretty enormously far and the laser pointer is incredibly powerful. Point that to B mode. See much the same. The illuminator is just slightly less powerful. All right, we're gonna push both of these up to full power mode. So you have the C1 Plus and A button. You can see that easily reaches out to 300. We're gonna turn around behind us. We're gonna push it out to about 400. You can see it easily illuminates those trees at 400, no problem. B button, we have the laser pointer only. We compare that to the DA. The DA is incredibly powerful in full power mode, with a ridiculously powerful illuminator, easily reaching 400. The DA will easily do 1,000. Okay, point that back at the 300 meter tree. You can see it's incredibly powerful, and at the target, illuminates that easily. In laser mode only, we have a just lightsaber throwing out. All right, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna compare the C1 Plus against the PEC 15, which is the current military, or one of the military issued models. So we're gonna bump that bad boy up to full power, and then we'll see how it does. So you have the caps off. All right. So as you can see there, we have the illuminator on the PEC 15 is pretty good. So we twist it all the way down. You can see we get a kind of a beam pattern similar to the C1 Plus. We're gonna compare that to the high mode, or the long mode on the C1 Plus. As you can see, the MAL has less kind of artifacting compared to the illuminator from the PEC 15. Pretty incredible. Of course, the laser is more powerful, but that's due to restricted versus non-restricted. Okay, so we have that PEC 15. If we compare that directly to the DA on high power, the DA has a ridiculously powerful illuminator. We can pull that illuminator open a little bit as far as it will go. So it does get wider at the long distance. However, the illuminator is not that bright at all.
and nowhere near as powerful or as good as the illuminators on the mall is. Point that in 400 meters away, you can see how good the illuminator on the mall is. We'll go ahead and we'll focus in the PEC. All right, kind of have it a similar dispersion compared to the mall. As you can see, due to the technology used, the mall has a much better throw and illumination than does the PEC 15. All right, putting away the DA for a sec. We have the PEC 15 versus the mall C1 Plus. So comparing them together, you can see that the mall has better illumination throw even than a full power PEC, although the laser is less powerful. Okay, we're gonna compare the C1 Plus against the A4. We have the mall, and then as is typical, as I've run into many times with the A4, it has failed due to temperature changes, and this is kind of something I've run into quite a bit, so no comparison when it comes to that. We have the comparisons versus the various models. Again, just so you can see, we have C1 Plus at A mode with a huge illuminator, B mode, the shorter illuminator. We have mid-range mode. You can see here my dog running down the street right there. And then we have the far mode. And again, that direct comparison at short range between the both. Here is C1 Plus. Here's the DA, fairly similar, pushing them both to mid-range. We have the C1 Plus on the left, and we have the Mall DA on the right. And then we have them both on long-range mode. And as you can see, the DA is more powerful, but it's not as big as you'd think it would be. Pretty cool overall. It's amazing how much technology has improved since the PEC 15. The mall is just an incredible piece of technology.
So as you can see here from that little video right there, the mall is a really cool device and its ability to illuminate a variety of different situations, push past photonic barriers. There are some devices that come close to it. Steiner D2 is definitely close, but the Steiner D2 is also enormously fat and wide and is just massively heavy. And also you can't adjust the illuminator. I understand that you do have a white light on it, but it's not very good. I don't think that the D2 is a good unit at all. It's also horrendously tall with terrible controls. But that's enough shit talking on the D2. But it comes with some other problems. You can see it downrange a lot easier due to the type of illumination technology that the D2 is utilizing. I haven't had time on the A4 yet, but I've heard much the same complaints with the A4. The Mall is a phenomenal unit. Now, there are a couple things with the Mall. Specifically, you do have weight. So the Mall does weigh around 10.1, 10.2 ounces, depending. The PEC 15 is around 7.2. LA5 is a little bit more. NGAL is, or NGAL, however you want to call it, is around 5, maybe about 4 ounces. So the Mall is definitely about twice the weight of the more modern NGAL and a little bit more than the PEC 15, but I do believe that the extra weight is absolutely worth it for the capabilities that you get. There is no doubt in my mind that the Mall is the best IR unit currently on the market. I don't think that anything touches it in terms of ergonomics and controls. Now, I know that some people have stated that they've had zero-in problems with the Mall. The only thing I can say to that is me and the people that I know have not had any issues with it. But I will say that anytime you have a change of environment, temperature, humidity, elevation, I always re-zero my optics. I always want to be absolutely sure. There can be small MOA incremental adjustments as that happens. Things shift, and that goes for both the PEC 15 or any other IR laser device or any optic out there, even aim points. So make sure you re-zero everything. I always do that every time I change or before I roll on something. It's important to make sure that everything is re-zeroed and good. So make sure you do that with them all. I haven't seen any any problems with the unit holding zero, but I just want to throw that out there for you guys to make sure that you're double checking everything. Guys, this is the best IR unit. They are really expensive, $2,500. And that comes into a couple things. So first off, when it comes to IR units, unfortunately, we're not able to own full power units as civilians, and that's an absolute travesty. But unfortunately, that's the law and the way it is. Now, you can find full power units for sale out there, like PEC 15 or even the Mall or others. And the problem with that is a couple things. One, with your PEC 15s, they're typically dermoed, and what that means is essentially they're either not fit for service or there's some problem with them. Sometimes they're surplus, but for the most part, it's because they've been used for a while and they're just not working that well. So a lot of times you get a PEC 15 that's not working very well, it's not putting out its correct output, or it has issues where it just doesn't straight up work. That's happened to a lot of buddies who have bought them. Another problem is once your unit breaks, you're kind of SOL. There are some ways around it, and I'm sure some people have some little tricks in that type of thing, but for most people who aren't connected, you're kind of just SOL. If you send this back to L3, they're gonna know precisely where this came from, and they're gonna be like, thank you, and you're not gonna get that bad boy back. And that sucks. I hate that that happens, but that is the unfortunate nature. Without a doubt, the C1 Plus is by and far the best IR unit out there. There's nothing that comes close to it in the civilian market. When it comes to full powers, there are some choices out there, and I think the MALT fills a really good role in conjunction with a couple other really good military units like the NGAL and some other ones that are currently in the pipeline. But I love the MALT for almost every situation that I have. So if you can afford one, definitely pick them up. Guys, here's the thing. You're not going to look cool with any of this stuff unless you get training. When it comes to night vision training, there are a couple people out there who I definitely recommend, especially we have Silent Solutions, Greenline Tactical, TNVC, all put on really good stuff. And I can't thank those guys enough for all of the support they've done for this video. Definitely go check those guys out. Esoteric Darcy also have really good night vision training programs. Check those guys out as well. Night vision is not a cheap game, but it is a very necessary game for a variety of situations. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching. Love you guys. And of course, I've got nothing else for you. Last thing for you guys, if you have people who are bringing you down, don't feel afraid to let these people go. There are some people who just want to watch the world burn. Don't allow them to drag you down with them. Don't go down with the ship. Cut ties. Make sure that you're living a healthy life. If they're constantly just giving you worry and pain, leave that behind and push forward into a great year. Ladies and gentlemen, love you guys so much. You know, if you've gotten this far, that the biggest way to help me is Patreon. Patreon supporters directly support everything here. You guys have made these videos so much better. I can't thank you guys enough. Definitely go check out the link and support me if it is within your means. Can't thank you guys enough. Stay tuned. Plenty more cool videos coming. Love you guys. I've got nothing else for you.